Welcome to day 24, Saturday, of our lockdown diaries. I'm going to finish off on a couple of topics that I've sort of got a little few little loose ends on, and one is on turntables and the other is on tubes versus transistors. So I'll do the second one first, the tubes versus transistors. Okay, here you can see a VTL book, which is everything you ever wanted to know about tube amplifiers and design, but were afraid to ask. They're pretty hard to come by, these copies nowadays, but I can probably loan one to local people that want to have a read and return it to me. But anyway, it's got some really good stuff inside it, which I'll show you a little bit of later, but I just thought I'd show you a couple of different things. This here is a solid state device. It's an LM3886, and it is basically an amplifier, a complete amplifier in one package, and that's what most solid state amplifiers today use in some form or another, not necessarily the same model. But this one will give you, for 35 volts in, that's a plus 35 and a negative 35, so two rails, this will give you 60 watts output into 8 ohms. That's that little package there, so that's a solid state device. This device here is a KT88 tube, which will give you about 50 watts output for a single tube, and about 100 watts for a pair of these. My VTL amplifiers have 24 of these tubes in them, 12 in each monoblock. And this is a preamp tube. So this is a triode tube. And this I'll show you a little bit more about when I go into differences of tubes. When we look at these tube specs in the book here, we can see the specifications are all given for the voltages, and where the voltage for this solid state device was 35 volts, for the beam power tube, which is what the KT8 is, it's a beam tetrode. So the KT88 beam tetrode has a voltage of a design maximum of 800 volts. I don't know anybody that's going anywhere near that for modern designs. And basically these will normally run somewhere between 470 and 600 volts, depending on the design, how hard the designer wants to push the tube. And you can see the other details there as to how you would use that tube in a pair in an output stage in the left-hand side there. So those are the differences in tubes physically, and I'll go into a bit more detail on that tomorrow. Now I want to show you a bit about vibration on turntables and isolation, but it's a little bit noisy at the moment because outside here today it is absolutely chucking it down, and so it's a little bit noisy with the rain on the roof. Even though I have an isolated room, my ceiling is designed to be lossy to let sound out from the room into the roof space, and that means I also get a little bit of noise coming in when it is raining like it is at the moment, and that's pretty heavy out there, but I think it looks like it's going to clear up, so I'll just start filming once this eases. Okay, a good test for you to do to see whether your turntable is isolating from external vibrations is to put the stylus on the record without the record actually turning, and turn your volume up to around about what you'd normally listen at. You can start with a lower volume if you're a bit worried about doing this, and just take it up slowly. And then tap on the surface that your turntable is sitting on, like this. And you can hear a slight amount coming through the speakers compared to what you would get if you tap on the actual plinth of the turntable. You can hear that coming through the speakers quite a lot less than you would in a lot of turntables. Difference between the two, of course, is how much the turntable design is absorbing the vibrations that are coming through. These use feet designed by HRS, the
gentleman who runs that company. His main job is involved with designing electron microscope isolation systems and very sensitive test equipment, very high-end type of gear. And MoFi gave him the job of designing some feet that use very specialised isolation systems inside them with elastomers and so forth to be designed to pick out the frequencies that they particularly want to block from getting into the turntable to muddy up the sound. So that's a little test that you can do just quite simply to find out whether your turntable is susceptible to external vibrations, and then you can experiment with different feet and isolation platforms to see if you can reduce that noise that you get coming through when you tap your cabinet. Another thing you can do, of course, is add mass to the cabinet, which will result in less vibration coming through from the floor and externally. A little trick for you is some turntables, including the MoFis, when the belts are new and they're quite grippy, being rubber, when you turn them on, you can hear a little squeaky sort of noise. If you get that or a shuddering to the platter, just do this. Grab yourself a seal grip bag, put a bit of talcum powder in it, pop your belt into there, shake it around a bit, take the belt out, put it on. The talc will just give you a little bit of slip when the motor is first starting up, which will stop that vibration or squeakiness that it makes. So there's a couple of little tips for vinyl for today. Now to listen to a bit of music.
Strong, we were wanted all along. I was taught to fight, taught to win.
So that album is called Sounds from Quincy Jones. The track was Taking It to the Streets, and it was from 1978.
Valentine's I never knew, the Friday night show. isn't all it seems. It's 17. A brown-eyed girl in hand-me-downs, whose name I never could pronounce, said, pity please the ones who serve. They only get what they deserve.
That's our video for today. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe down below. And I'm happy to hear your comments and for you to share this around. Thank you for watching.